They say every journey starts with a single step. And sometimes that first step is the hardest one to take. And some people spend a lifetime finding reasons not to do the things they dream of doing. Aim for the Horizon is the story of my friend Rob proving to me that anyone can have an adventure, and regardless of your situation, you should try to realise your dreams. But my dream of owning and riding a motorbike turned out to be a bigger journey than I'd imagined, as Rob decided to take it one step further. Now, I didn't know how building my own bike, riding off-road, sleeping rough, or scaring myself half to death was going to benefit me in the years to come, but at the time, Rob decided it was what I needed to have a proper adventure and possibly change my outlook forever. So, with absolutely no idea what was to come, I agreed. And before I had time to change my mind, he'd booked me in for my theory test.
That's where it all starts. Theory test centre. I'm going in now, and so I could come out of here smiling, or come out of here depressed. We'll find out. So, I'll back in a minute and see how I got on.
I failed. 3 questions. 3 bloody questions. Let me just give you a multiple choice. Go get 43. I got 39. I was 4 questions. And hazard perception, flying colours. 60 out of 70, so that's about an 85, 90% pass, isn't it? Yeah. Failed on 4 questions, guys. Back to drawing board. What do I do now, Rob?
So Rob said, you can do your CBT.
To pass the test, you've got to ride the way they want you to ride. I know that sounds like a safe way as well. So you're going to have, initially, 9:30 start, you have a bit of a theory, we'll take you upstairs, we'll talk about clothing, the right kind of clothing to wear, look at helmets, safety features and things to consider wearing, okay? That should take us about 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes. Okay. Back down again, what we'll then do is we'll cut out to a bike, we'll go and have a look at a bike, bike familiarisation, I'll just run through the basic controls with you. Most of it, if you've ridden before, it'll come back to you. It's going to be familiar, so don't worry too much about that.
That's it, moment of truth. CBT.
CP. Compulsive basic training.
That's what I just said, CBT. See, it's hard enough. Moment of truth, CBT today. Going to go out and learn how to ride a motorbike, and hopefully we can get to where we want to be. Wish me luck. I'm popping myself out.
See you later. Okay, it's a 125 motorcycle sim. So, do you know where the clutch is?
Clutch is on the side.
Yeah, do you know where the front brake is?
Yeah.
Yeah, the accelerator?
Yeah.
Back brake?
Other side.
Yeah. Okay. The only other thing that we need to really point out is on here, you've got your gear lever.
Yeah.
Down into first, back up into second. Right, what's the tread depth for a moped?
Dunno. No, I'm honest, there you go.
The CBT is about getting on the bike for the very first time and learning the basics. But this is more than just getting on a bike for me. I've been wanting to do this for the last 20 years. Now, this may only be a 125, but the only way I was going to get on a bigger bike was by passing my CBT. So it's head down and practice. So after 3 hours riding around a car park, all I had to do was prove to my instructor I could ride safely on the road, and I passed.
Thank you. Theory test part 2. We're back again, hopefully this time with my revision and my multiple passes in my mock test, we should be okay. I'm going in, you know the rest.
I really hate this. Come on.
Yeah, we passed now. Oh, Mampus are pathetic. It's pathetic, isn't it? No, we passed. They're flying colours this time. Nothing to worry about. Do you know, I can't remember being as nervous because I failed the first time. I walked out and they're like that out there. Can I have your licence again, please? And you think, oh my God, not again, not another 30 quid. But anyway, got a pass. I've only got a couple of wrong this time, which is cool. So flew through it and heading off down now to book the direct access. So it's happy days and the coffee's on me. So I passed my theory and my CBT and booked my direct access. But the thing was, I wanted a bike of my own to ride. Now Rob said I wouldn't get a decent one for under £2,000, but I think I found a beauty for 900 quid. So we went and picked it up.
No BMWs are being dropped off at the garage, at the headquarters. We're at the Telford services and we're waiting for the guy to drop the bike off. I bought off eBay, he's turning up. And Robbie's going to drive it home, so the cheapness continues. It's going to be bloody freezing.
So I'd bought a Honda Africa Twin 750 in the worst colours ever.
Take it easy, yeah?
Yeah, we'll follow you.
It's just for you, not that. I'm just worried about you.
Oh, sorry. Wipe your visor, son. Wipe your visor. Can't we scream while we've had to go fast enough?
Holy Maloney.
How you doing?
Yeah, it's all right.
Sure?
You've got a very wet hand. Crack on,
son.
Yeah. The man out there on a second-hand bike, £900 off eBay, driving it home in the rain. If you think you can't do this, you're wrong. This is proper stuff. So funny. The bike's not too bad. It's not riding straight, so I should imagine the back wheel's out of alignment. The brakes are shot.
Really?
I'm not having to brake because they're on all the time. The front steering yoke bearings have got a little bit of play in them. Just needs looking after that. You know, it's just, I don't know what to say, really. Knackered. I can't let him ride it around like that.
No.
He wanted to just not do anything with it, didn't he, for a while?
Yeah.
No, he's not having that. The brakes don't work. We are now definitely going. This is 900 quid's worth of eBay glory you're looking at here. Africa Twin, 1993, RD04, get down. And we are just about to strip it down to its bare bones. Yeah, exactly, and Ross has helped us as well.
Don't say bones.
Bones, I said bones. I've got my face on. Stop it. Turn the camera off, I'm gonna hit you with a hammer. Here we are then, stage two. Halfway through my test, really. Got my test on Friday. That means nothing to you because it could be any Friday. But I'd like to introduce you to my eBay glory. Here it is, the whole thing. Look at that. 1993 Africa Twin RD04.
RD07.
It's an RD07. Just testing your home. Looks a bit. It drives great. MOT to May 09. So you could be watching this at any time. But we've got to strip it down to its bare bones and make it look fantastic because I like things all shiny and new. Rob's the expert. You're probably not going to see a lot of Rob until we actually go biking. But Rob, this is going to cost me a fortune.
Dean wants to paint it until it works better, but I want to pull it apart and do it properly.
So we're going to do it properly.
And when Rob means properly, he means properly. This is going to be a complete nut and bolt rebuild, and I haven't got a clue what I'm doing.
So with the bike in bits, it was time for me to take the last part of my test, the direct access. The last bike I rode was a 125. Now this is a 500cc and it's fast. But it's not all about going fast. You've got to prove that you can control this bike even when you're not riding it. I struggled with my U-turns, but everything else seemed to come quite naturally. And after 4 days of practice, my instructor Pierce said I was ready for my test.
It's my test. It's been, every day I've been here, like, chat, cup of coffee, chilling out. The day of my test, I've got an hour before I'm... less than an hour before I got my test, and I'm here, I've got to go and have a practice ride. I don't know. I'll pop a few wheelies, it'll be fine.
Is it? Hopefully, this will be the last time I have to ride this. And one day, hopefully, the bits I have in the garage might sound like that.
They're not.
No, because they're better than that.
Yeah.
What are you saying to me, Rob? Have I bought a part? Have I bought £900 worth of parts?
You have, yeah, but we're going to make it good.
Standing in the car park waiting for my test to begin, I thought that my adventure was nearly over. But Pierce said, from what he'd heard, my adventure hadn't even started. After 45 minutes and a faultless test run, I was hoping my instructor hadn't seen I turned in the exit. But he had.
Done it. We don't have to worry about me anymore, do we?
No.
Do you know what I mean? It's all down to me and my test, and I've been really stressed this week. All I've been thinking about are motorbikes.
Have it!
And I just thought it would be really straightforward, and it's been really difficult. Do you know what I mean? It's been, not difficult, but the stress, and you, to do this in 4 or 5 days, intensive course is worth doing, but I tell you what, I'm just ecstatic.
Just gonna give my my bib back, because I don't need it anymore.
I can ride any of these in here. Any of these bikes I can ride.
Ride any of them badly.
And it's just been intense. And I have to say, Taz and Piers and all the lads, genius. And you know, if you're gonna do this, go to a proper training school, listen to what they're saying, because even if you think you know better, and even if you've been thinking you've been riding 125 and you know it, listen to these boys because they'll save your life. It shows you that even if you're 42, right, or 52 or 60, don't worry about it. When I came out, there's a gentleman who was a little bit older than me, probably in his 50s, late 50s, passed his test as well. Everyone can do this, and you can do it cheap.
It was time to strip the bike down to the frame. Now at this point, if you'd asked me what I was doing, I would have had to lie. The only thing I had in common with Rob was the overalls.
Right, we're here because we've got a problem. We took the bike apart, as you've probably we've seen so far. Got to the frame and it was rotten. It was rotten all the way through in some parts. We went to have it sandblasted and powder coated. So I bought it to young Eric here, 40 years in the business, expert of the game, going to weld it up for me. But what's the damage, Eric? I know you started, but what's the damage?
Well, the damage is these are quite thin-walled material.
Okay.
And the bike in this normal plane of motion sits down and all the water runs down here, gathers in here,
yeah,
and it rots from the inside out.
Because this is 15 years old, isn't it?
That's so right. Yeah. I mean, I've come across other Hondas that do this.
Right.
But however, what we're going to do is I'm going to cut this right back to the weld.
Okay.
Right back to this weld here. Okay. and then make you another new piece out of 14 gauge steel, which is a bit thicker than this.
Okay.
Weld it all back into place. It has to take the shape because the engine comes quite close.
Right, yeah, sure it does, yeah.
That's that one.
Okay.
Then there's this slight problem, which, okay, it's a subframe.
Oh, this is right rotten.
Right. And what we have to do here, there's one each side, as you can see, but I'll show you this side. I've got to chop these all off here with a disc cutter, then chop this off there, then free this from the rotted piece, fit you a nice piece of 2mm wall thick tube in there,
but
so
solid,
it never happened again, yes.
Rather than hollow.
2mm thick, yeah. Then weld these all back into position. What I've got to do is I've got to take a slight template across here, so I'll make sure they get back in the right place.
Come on! You know that when your bike isn't actually in the garage anymore, it's in like four or five different places, you've got to go and pick it all up. You know that you're committed. So then, you saw her going in the oven, being sprayed. She's back. This is the moment. This is the moment where it all starts coming together. We have a brand new frame. I've got to get inside because I want to see what she looks like. Rewelded, shot glassed, powder coated.
Oh, look. She's beautiful. So here we are then, about halfway through, well, more than halfway through, three quarters of the way through, the engine's in. We've got to the wheel stage now. We've put the suspension in today, put the swing arm back on. But we couldn't put the original wheels on because the original wheels, one of them got here, got the rear wheel, is pretty much indicative of what the bike was like when we bought it. 15 years old, 93 model, starting to corrode through, the spokes were gone, and really in a bad state of a repair, sort of probably an accident waiting to happen. We have now this baby. Brand new stainless steel wheel, spokes as well, rebuilt. We've also replaced all of the bearings. One of the two of the bearings seemed a bit dodgy, and it seems silly to take a wheel out and not do a full job on it. So we've done that. Bearings both sides on this. It wasn't just the back, it was the front. These are not as bad, but if you're going to replace one, you might as well replace them both. Stainless steel, new bearings, going to put some new seals on here as well and get them up and running, and we should be on the next stage.
Rob wanted to spend the remainder of the budget on the engine, so I completely ignored him and spent it on paint and stickers. That green and purple had to go. I decided on my design, and it's down to the sign writers to make it all happen. It's amazing to watch these guys work. Slowly but surely, my design appears before my very eyes. With the final stickers applied, it was time to put a coat of lacquer on to stop them peeling off. And then it was time to put it all back together again. Now, as Rob was sulking about the engine, he told me I had to do it myself, so I did. Putting this bike back together was really therapeutic, because this bike was in a worse state than I was. But it just shows you, with a little help, care, attention and hard work, you can fix anything. And it got me thinking, all these things Rob's getting me to do were really taking my mind off all my worries.
Thank you.
on.
So 3 months down the line then, and what have we achieved? I've passed my test, I've bought a bike, I've stripped it down, and I've rebuilt it again. All of that, completely and utterly a journey, but I still have got to go on the trip, and I don't even know where I'm going.
Right then, fellas.
Hello, Wayne.
What can we do for you then? All right.
Well, it's interesting. We're going on a trip, an adventure. We're making a program, and we're going on an adventure in, you know, in June, I think it's
in June.
And I'm a new biker. I've just passed my test. I've just gone through the whole thing, all the stress of it all.
And you're going on an adventure.
I'm going on an adventure. However, I need some kit because, of course, I've got my bike now, but I haven't got any equipment, as it were. So we come to you today for some advice, really.
How long have you got? There's a lot of advice coming your way, or there could be. We could summarise very quickly. I need to ask some questions, obviously, as to likes of where you're going, what sort of climate it's going to be, what type of bike.
He doesn't actually know where he's going yet, because we're not going to tell him. We're near the time.
You're a new biker, and you don't know where you're going on an adventure, and he's organising it.
Yeah.
Right, you're not very clever then, are you? Because you're definitely going to have the... You could say you drew the short straw.
Well, there you go.
And you got the good straw, because you choose.
I can plan where he's going to go, and he's definitely going to get
hot. And you're not going to tell us.
I can't tell you in front of him, but he's definitely going to be doing some long distances.
Yeah.
He's going to be hot, he's going to be cold, he's going to be going off-road, and a fair bit of motorway riding as well.
Flipping heck. Right, so, okay. Right.
But well, I know more than I did when I came in.
Yeah, did you? Right, I see what you mean. Well, we better not give too many secrets away. The truth is, we at Revit try and do specific gear for specific purposes. So I suppose the appropriate gear might be associated with the word adventure. You build into the kit as much variable comforts, if you want, and paramount safety. You know, it's very, very important. Safety is obviously right up the top of the list.
Of course.
So we try and build that into one range of garments. Now we call that the Cayenne Pro, and the Pro defines the fact that it is for good, hardy, possibly professional use.
So it'd be good on the road, off the road, hot, cold.
Just about everywhere. I mean, we have had people who've travelled the world who literally sleep in it.
So kitted out in new gear, we said goodbye to our friend Wayne.
Ah, thank God they've gone.
And then Rob told me I needed to learn to ride off road, and he knew just the man.
Do you know what I realised? Do you know what date it is today?
Friday.
Do you know what date it is today?
The 13th.
It's Friday the 13th. I've never done this before, so I'm now thinking, I'm under pressure because we've got to leave.
Yeah.
And I'm now thinking, oh no.
So my contact lens has just come out.
Oh, it's all game wrong. Do you know, I'm knackered already. I haven't been gone anywhere yet. Gloves, hat, jacket. Key, me, rucksack, dog indoors. All the gear, no idea. First major trip out for me and Rob, with all our bits and pieces. And we're going to Wales, because we've been told it's probably a good idea that I learn to ride off-road. Now, we have to consider that I've only just learned to ride on-road for the last 4 months, so this is going to be really interesting.
Oh my God. When they said we were going camping in Wales, they didn't say they were going to drop us in the middle of nowhere.
Forgot to tell you, the haunted farm is just over there.
Oh, fantastic.
About just a quarter of a mile at all.
Yeah.
Plan this morning is to take the boys just in a little loop through the forestry down there. Some stony tracks, some grassy trails, and just a little warm up really. Have your wits about you. And like I said last night, it's forward thinking, plan ahead.
Yeah, I'm
going
to be tarting my way around here, so bear with me, won't you?
Yeah, you'll be fine. Well done, really good. Yeah, going down into that bottom corner, just slow it right down, let the engine do its work, the engine brake, and just hold into, pull your knees into a tank and just go around it quietly. And nice, go around nice and wide. Yeah. They're doing really well, really well.
It's greasy out here this morning.
Yeah, they're nervous first thing as well, they're really stiff coming down here.
You can see that they're not, you can see they're loosening up a little bit.
Yeah, yeah, it's starting to get the adjuster coming down there, yeah.
We've had the guys this morning just doing some nice simple loops on the big bikes and the Africa Twins, just to get a bit of a benchmark for them really, to understand where they started from, and we've just been in the woods now. We're going to do something very different. We're going to sort of take them and build on the bit of confidence that we've already got with them, and we're going to take them up onto a nice big open piece of moorland with a whole range of different bikes, a 125, a 250 two-stroke and a 450. And we're just going to give them a chance to just experiment really, and just learn about balancing on the bikes, how to put the weight in the right places, and just get a feel for how different bikes react under different conditions. And hopefully that'll build their confidence up even more before they go out on a bit of a trip this afternoon, a bit of a ride out with Craig, and have a go at really trying to do some stuff which is a little bit more complex, a little bit further away from home, just building them up bit by bit by bit. That's the plan.
That's the first. Sorry about that.
No. Oh, exhausted. Hang on, I need a rest. I'm so exhausted.
Go through there. Go through there. Yeah, right.
He looks shot.
Oh God. I'm going to inject this bottle. I am in complete and utter, I can't think, I can't talk. It's a first.
So we go for a nice trail ride this afternoon, eh? Yeah? You up for that?
To be honest, no. Now, I've been a qualified fitness instructor in my time, but I've never been this exhausted. And I told the guys I'd hit rock bottom. So they took me home. 3 hours, across country, the hard way.
Life is just this cosseted ball of cotton wool, isn't it? We don't get exhausted, we don't push ourselves, we don't stretch ourselves, and you go outside those boundaries for the first time. It's a scary place, you know?
Come on, Dean. Dean Wilson. Have it.
What he is tired, but if you're not used to being tired, it's a scary feeling, you know? It's all new, isn't it?
Nice and steady. That's it. Stay with it. Job done.
That's more like it.
I can't. Oh shit, Rob. I'm sorry.
Are you alright?
I'll be right, that's just.
You did well.
Now that's leaving your comfort zone. You right? What do you need? A cup of tea.
I'm just exhilarated, terrified, and just f***ing ill. So emotional. Sorry.
You're all right, come on. Get your helmet off.
No, I'm fine, better. I'm fine. That was good. Oh.
You did well.
You made it back. And I'm tired.
Absolutely exhausted, but God, I don't do crying. I gotta tell you, if you're sitting at home wishing you should do something, I should. I can't. I'm about to say, if you're sitting there thinking you should do something and life's too short, it is. I've been had lots of things going in my life in the last few. That's the hardest thing I've ever done. And I'm not just emotional because I didn't think I could do it. And then my limbs are coming out. Today has been
brilliant.
Brilliant. Awesome.
Absolutely brilliant.
Outstanding. Everyone should do it. But I'm absolutely, can I say what I am without swearing?
A big girl?
No, I'm not a big girl. Oh, come on, that was tough today. It was tough today. It was the toughest thing I've ever done. But do you know what? The purpose of this was to get me, Rob as well, really, at this stage, on bikes and proper. So, you know, when you're going away, you're not just sticking to tarmac. And considering that I've never taken this bike off the road ever, I've taken my test and been on the road and larged it around. Look at how, aren't we brilliant? Don't we look good? And this is the real world, isn't it? This is what the real adventurers do. And if you're an adventurer, I thought an adventurer is just go out on a bike and take a towel and some soap and you're off. But this is what it's about, being in the wilderness, riding places that people don't really know about, expanding your knowledge, but also pushing yourself. Because I am wasted today. I am now absolutely exhausted, but exhilarated. And this is what this is all about, is doing it, making it happen, showing you the ups, showing you the downs.
And if you've got enough determination, anybody can do it.
I'm really philosophical now, aren't I? I was buzzing earlier and the adrenaline's dropped and I'm like, ready for my beer. No, it's amazing. You know, you could sort of wax lyrical about it forever. But the thing is to keep watching. And see what we get up to next, because we haven't finished, have we?
No, and you've already been reduced to tears.
Yeah, I know. Well, that was I mentioned that earlier on, because the thing is, I can't explain that. Some people do things different ways, and I'm not embarrassed. But, lots of stuff has happened over the last few years, and today I've conquered tons of stuff. I've been fearful for my life for hours.
Yeah.
And it does something to you. I'm sorry, it changes you. And I'm out here now. I've got a fire and a tent and us and friends. We've got some friends here, obviously. But it changes because this is raw now. We've had to light this. We haven't actually gone down and got a pack of briquettes.
No.
This is proper.
We've had to use like a cigarette lighter and everything.
I don't know if the guys had realised it, but they'd hit my reset button and I was ready for more.
This is a fairly typical kind of British sort of trail riding trail, really. This is kind of thing that most guys are doing when they come out Sunday afternoons like this. You come out for a bit of a ride and this is the sort of stuff you'd be riding on. You've got to sort of get out of your head the idea that you're riding on roads, really. It's not like riding on a road. You know, when you're riding a road, you put your helmet on, you put your boots on, you go out, you come back, and that's all that happens. But when you ride off-road, you do the same thing, but part of it is also falling off. And it might not look it, but I was in control of that. It's just that I stopped. So you went straight across, I suppose.
Yeah.
This is so hard.
It is, yeah.
I don't care, I'm up the top in one piece.
A couple of months ago, you couldn't even ride a bike, mate.
Yeah, it's true.
When you go in a section like this, really on a bike this size, you're not really going to be able to make any decisions while you're going up this slope about where to go.
Just go.
What you need to do is pick your line at the bottom, get your bike lined up, make it so that it's right, get yourself set, and then use momentum to get you up the hill.
Oh well, give it a go.
Pick your bike up, right? You want to give your handlebars full leverage, okay? Okay. So you've got good leverage. You don't want to like that. So you won't have no leverage. You're just pulling against it, okay? Okay? You don't want to be pulling the bike up here.
Okay.
You just can't do it, right? It won't go up. So your handlebars are actually acting as a lever. So you're pulling full leverage and get your legs bent, right? So you know they damage your back and just walk into the bike, yeah?
Yeah.
Halfway up, if you're struggling, put your knee into the bike, yeah? Got my knee into it again, yeah? No problem. And just walk into the bike, yeah?
And have a rest, yeah?
All right? Got that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Didn't do that on the CBT.
No. Go on, walk into it, walk. Get your knee into it. Excellent, well done.
Superb.
Bend your legs, yeah? Walk into it. That's it, walk into it. Put your knee into it. Awesome. Well done. Superb.
I feel Rob and Dean have coped exceptionally well this weekend. Their main objective was just again riding gently off-road on like gravelly fire roads. But obviously today we've just raised our game and they've been doing some extreme stuff actually. Going up some real tough tracks. So he'd done really, really well.
What a weekend. All that was left to do was to say goodbye to our new friends Craig and Dave. And I think they were sad to see us go.
Dave, cheers, Dave.
No worries, man, it's been a pleasure. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Well done.
Cheers, Dave. Thanks for everything.
No worries, man. Brilliant. You take care of yourself, all right?
Yeah, I will. You're right, definitely.
Safe. Craig! Well done, man. Well done.
Cheers, man. Oh, they're pulling me off my bike.
Well done.
We'll see you guys soon.
Take care.
Ta-da.
Real soon.
I am glad they're gone.
Well, it's 21 days until we leave for our trip, and Dean's had a bit of bad news. His stepmum's passed away, and he's had to go up to Doncaster to see his dad, because his dad's very upset, and of course everybody's upset. So I'm in the garage, and I'm looking at Dean's bike, because when we went down to Wales, it used an awful lot of oil, and it was smoking, so we had a compression test and it turned out that, you know, it wasn't very good. So I've completely stripped the engine down and I've found we've got some huge problems. So the best option was to try and get another complete engine. So we hunted high and low and we found one. Dean bought the new engine, absolutely lovely engine, nothing much too wrong with it at all apart from the final drive bearing had gone, and that usually means when the chain's too tight it puts a lot of strain on the final drive on the engine and it just wears the bearing out, and here's the culprit here.
Of course, this is where your pistons go on your comrades, that spins round, up and down, drives the engine round. You've got a load of gearbox and everything that goes through here, and on the end of here, your sprocket where your chain which drives your back wheel goes.
And as the engine drives it round, that drives the chain, that drives the back wheel. But what they do, they over tighten the chain, which puts a lot of strain on this bearing, and it's worn this bearing out. That's not good.
It seems like a lot of work.
It is a lot of work, but I'm a little bit of a geek and I quite like it.
Rob was right about the engine, and he'd spent so many hours repairing my bike, it meant that he didn't have time to check his own before going on the trip. So the least I could do was book both bikes in for a full health check at our local Honda dealer. We'd built up such a great relationship with Honda over the last few months with parts and support that we knew our bikes were in good hands. And we rode away confidently with a clean bill of health.
Now you're fitting a sat nav, and you're fitting a sat nav to mine.
You're fitting your sat nav to yours.
Well, yeah, that's what I meant. Why do I have to take all mine apart and you're sitting on yours doing it without it being taken apart?
Well, I'll do it in a minute.
Oh, you're doing it the other way around?
Yeah.
Just checking, because I thought it might be a joke.
No, it's no joke.
You might think, what the hell is he doing? But I'm protecting Rob's floor, because I'm just about to take the fuel off, and fuel normally drips out, and if I drip fuel on his garage floor, he gets a bit annoyed. But then, of course, you've got to turn the tap off.
You're doing
really well, Dean. Yeah, I'm doing great over here. Oh, come on, you monkey. That's been put on the wrong way, then.
No, I double-checked that.
You didn't? No, I didn't, obviously. The thing is, it always goes wrong when Rob's here. When I'm at home, right, everything goes perfectly. Whenever Rob's here, right, it always goes wrong. This is where I copy Rob's nests. I let him do it, and then, of course, and then I just go back to the template and copy his. It's easy, isn't it? Instructions? Who needs instructions? Right, it's 8:10, Thursday evening. We're there. I've just wired in sat-nav, and I'm just going to check see if it works. We've had to wire it in, get it fused, and all the other things that goes wrong, and all the things that need checking. So we've checked everything. I've just got to put the bike back together again for the last time. This is probably, and hopefully, the last time I'm going to have to do this, tank and everything else. But the thing with the sat-navs, particularly the Garmin one I've got here, it's got to be wired into ignition, because obviously you don't want to be draining your battery when you're not using it. So this is the test. Does it come on when I turn on ignition? And if it doesn't, he'll laugh. It works!
I'm really surprised.
We're done. I'm going to see you in the morning, bright and early. What time? 9 o'clock? Leave?
Yeah.
We're leaving at 9 o'clock, so I'll see you then.
The next morning, I get a text from Rob telling me exactly where we're going. Leaving the UK, we're going into France, then Belgium, Germany, across to the Czech Republic, down through Austria, into Italy, and then we'll follow the south coast of France into Spain to meet Dave and Craig for my final surprise. Now, I was a bit concerned, because the last time I met those two, it ended in tears. Swan and I had never seen eye to eye about this trip, because she couldn't understand why I was going. But I'd made my mind up. It didn't make it any easier saying goodbye, though.
I'll get my partner in crime, I suppose.
As I left, it dawned on me. I was going to have to ride over 4,000 miles to get back home. Isn't life funny? It only seems like yesterday I was sitting in Rob's kitchen complaining about my life going down the plug hole. The next thing, I'm on a motorbike heading for Europe. I'm not saying this has been easy. I've even had to sell my car to pay for it all. But I had a funny feeling it was going to be worth it, because I was finally doing something I wanted to do. And I was loving it. Before you know it, we're in France, heading for Germany. And we made it to Belgium before we set up camp. Although Belgium's famous for its chocolates, all we were interested in was a beer and a good night's sleep.
Just left sort of France and Belgium. We hit Belgium without realising it, to be honest. We just sort of nailed it, really. So we decided, with respect, that there's not a lot going on because we want to get to Germany. We want to keep on track with time.
Now about 250 kilometres, now 170 miles-ish away from the Mourne Dam. I'm not sure about the pronunciation, but if you've heard of the Dam Busters, this is one of the dams where one of the bouncing bombs struck. It's the largest of the reservoirs. And we're going to go there and we're going to have a little look because I've always wanted to see where that happened.
Look at that backdrop. All this water is supported by the dam that's up that other end, which is famous for the bouncing bomb. Yeah. The Lancasters would have come around. And actually, if you've ever watched the movie, they bear round. And then when they straighten up, this is where all the gun turrets were down on either side of the lake here. And they would have headed down here to the dam itself. It's absolutely serene. So we're chuffed to be here, and worth a visit, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, of course we are basing all our historical knowledge on the film The Dam Busters.
Yeah, because that's exactly how it worked.
Yeah, that's what I hear.
And because of the old dam business, I didn't think we'd be welcome.
Ah, we've got an invite to a party.
Yeah, well, you can hear and hear the next music.
Party.
Live music.
We'll go. How do you pronounce the name of this lake?
Moonazy. It's Moonazy.
Going for a boat ride out there this morning. We met some very nice gentlemen, lifeguards, funny enough, and for the lake. And they've agreed to take us out on the boat.
Morning, guys.
Morning.
How are you?
I'm fine, are you?
Yeah, we're good. We're good now.
The British Air Force has bombed this. Yes. So there is a TV movie make in the 60s.
That's right. Dam Busters.
Yes. And for training for bombing this dam, they built a smaller size dam in the Scotch Highlands. And this is very famous for a lot of guys around from British Army.
Yeah. Veterans.
I said yesterday about the dam, and we were sort of trying to get our facts right, and I wasn't far off because this is an amazing place, and people don't get to come and see this, do they? You know, and we're really lucky, the guys from the lifeguard have brought us out, but it makes you appreciate how fantastic the architecture is. Again, it's built in the 30s. I didn't know it's built in the 30s. It's not that old, really.
Underneath of these towers, they have a vent on the ground,
yeah.
Or otherwise, in about every 15 or 18 years, they have so much water inside that this is going over the wall here.
I find it quite awe-inspiring when I see things like this, and things with history. It's just, it's part of our history, isn't it? You know, all of us.
Yes.
Great.
Okay, now I will make maximum speed.
Hold on, guys, we're going.
Again, to the left again.
That's what this trip's all about, is doing things off the cuff. We didn't plan that.
But that's the whole point.
I'm all goose pimply.
So that was good, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's the Munisi Dam. We've stayed there a night, met some great people, had a party.
Oh yeah, did we? And now we've got some other places to find. So yeah. We better crack on. Our chariot awaits.
Leaving the Munnersee Reservoir, we rode through some of Germany's famous forests, and the scenery was stunning.
They absolutely love it.
I love it here. Just like paradise.
It was a biker's paradise, and I was loving it. And thanks to all the work Rob had done on the bike, it was running like a dream, and we were eating up the miles. It wasn't long before we were heading into the Czech Republic. Now, the roads weren't as good as they were in Germany, but it didn't matter, because I was riding my new favourite toy. We left the Munnersee Reservoir and headed for Carlo Viveri. Rob brought me to Carlo Viveri for three reasons. One, because it's where they shot my favourite movie, Casino Royale, at the Grand Hotel. Two, because it's a beautiful place and not many people come here. And because of that, three, it's a secret celebrity hideaway.
I didn't even know this existed, and it's beautiful. And I said to Rob, I'm coming back here.
Now, this trip is about seeing as many places as possible. So the next morning, we were back on the bikes, back on the road for our two-day journey to Italy.
We've looked at the weather, and we reckon it's going to rain, isn't it?
Yeah.
And being a couple of tarts as we are, there's no point getting wet if you don't need to. And the only option is, instead of staying in a posh five-star hotel, which we can't afford, we've come to ETAP, and like the Formula One, it's sort of cheap and cheerful, really, isn't it?
We didn't leave too late this morning, so we've done about 200 miles. I think we've still got about 250 to go tomorrow to get to Lake Garda.
So I had this fantasy driving around the hillsides, looking at the countryside for like 2 weeks. But there's some hardcore riding you need to do, don't you? You do have to do the autobahns, and you do have to sometimes nail it, as we've been saying, to get where you want to go. But there's, what I'm realising is there's always a prize.
You can either have your destinations as your goals, or you can go, instead of trying to cane loads of miles, you can go to one beautiful location and explore it. You don't know Europe inside out, you don't know all these villages, so the only way you can do it is to have a rough plan. Unless you're a complete geek and you want to book your hotels and your campsites all the way on the way, but that takes the fun out of it. Mm. Half the fun is finding that really pretty little campsite in the middle of nowhere and not knowing it was there.
Yeah. I just suddenly realised I've been in a tent for how many days now? What day are we on? Four? Five? Day four?
I don't know, I've lost track.
So I don't even know what day it is, that's how good it is. So we've been here for 5 days, I think, slept in a tent for four of them. This is only a very, very cheap and cheerful room with a basin and a bed in it. But to me, tonight's going to seem like a luxury hotel.
One night at the Ritz, and I'd gone soft. My head was all over the place.
I am concentrating,
Rob's cure for concentration? Off-roading.
About the rain in Europe, when it comes down, it really comes down, especially when you're in sort of these valleys and hilly areas. I suppose it's quite similar if you're in Wales or Scotland. But all the gears held up quite well.
It's the first rain on a bike. That was proper rain for me.
And come rain or shine, we were making good progress through Germany, and then Rob got distracted.
I've never been in a cable car before. And this one looks absolutely amazing. So we're going to go all the way up there.
We're here at Tal Station, which is 933 metres above sea level.
Yeah, that's right. What my sat nav said as well.
Yeah, but we're going to go 2,244 metres at Berg Station.
Rob knew I was scared of heights, and I didn't want to get in a rusty old cable car, but I knew if I didn't, I'd never hear the last of it.
It's just so far removed from anything that you'd ever see in England. You see it here and you feel privileged to be able to have a look at it, really. We're over 2,000 metres high, we're on top of a mountain, and it's absolutely gorgeous.
It's amazing!
I'd expect it to be barren and quite desolate and just with no sort of feeling at all. Because when you always see mountains, they always look quite scary and look like there's no life on there and you couldn't survive. But this is beautiful.
Mr. Mason?
Yeah, I've got a repossession order for you. I've been chasing you for hours.
I'm glad Rob's brought me on this trip. There's something about the great outdoors that really puts things into perspective. I couldn't have avoided the things that have happened to me, and now I realise I've spent far too long living my worries instead of living my life.
We're 200 miles behind schedule at the moment. It's just a milestone.
We had 200 miles to ride to reach our destination in Italy, and time was really against us. And that was such a shame, because as we entered Austria, the scenery just got better and better. And the countryside was constantly changing. But looking back at those mountains we'd just been up, I'm glad we came down when we did.
Coming up to about 10 o'clock, it's about 9:45, and we've been riding through Austria, and we got so engrossed with the roads as we entered Italy, we completely lost track of time. In the last half an hour, 40 minutes, we've tried a couple of campsites. One didn't do tents. One had closed down and one was completely full. Just do a late one down to Lake Garda and try and find a hotel there, campsite. At worst case scenario, just sleep by the lake. Where to? Favourites. Riva del Garda. Go. Made it to Lake Garda and stumbled across this little motorcycle hotel.
5:01 in the morning.
5:01 in the morning.
Managed to negotiate a deal, which includes a beer.
Steady on.
No, I can't.
I've realised it's not a holiday as such. It's more like an expedition to find out where I want to come with the people I love. It's hard to imagine. 6 months ago, I was taking my test and sweating about passing and even getting a bike. And I'm sitting now at Lake Garda in Italy, and two reasons. One, Italy is somewhere I always wanted to go to, and two, Lake Garda particularly, because it's really romantic. It's just a spectacular place to come. Did you see that water snake? Big water snake, and it had a fish in its mouth. And I was just about to get in there and have a swim, and I think I might go back up to where the proper beach is. I've gone all shivery now. Look, I've got goosebumps. Do you know, thought that was a stick.
I'm running out of pants.
I've got one pair of pants to last me 9 days or 8 days, or so, I don't know how many days they've got, but one pair of pants isn't going to cut it. You've got to wash your pants.
It's really amazing how when you don't have water, you really appreciate it. And it was either wash them here or wash them over there.
We left Lake Garda with 600 miles to do before we met Dave and Craig in Spain. But 600 miles along the French Riviera? Nice. Monaco, the sun, the yachts, the millionaires. All packed into one of the smallest countries in the world. But £4 for a can of Coke, you can keep it. The French Riviera, the millionaire's playground. Beautiful scenery, beautiful architecture, beautiful people. But meanwhile, down the road,
cooking on
gas.
So we're in Spain now. First, quite exciting, isn't it?
Rob's trying to find the directions to Dave Lomax, our friend. His friend lives here. He's going to take us around and about, and particularly in the Pyrenees. So this is really where the journey's culminating, the ultimate adventure for us, getting the stuff off the bikes and doing some off-roading. But today we're just going to stay here, hopefully find some of the camp, go to the beach and chill out for a bit, and then hopefully find Brian's house. And this should be fun.
What they don't know is one of the reasons their meeting is here, they're camping in Roses just up the road, is because this is also somewhere I do quite a lot of skydiving. And this afternoon, I think we'll take the opportunity to see if we can get them thrown out of an aeroplane.
So I'll help you focus.
No, hang on a minute. What do you mean?
What out are there?
I only wanted to pass me test, ride a bike. That's all I wanted to do. Why don't you just leave me alone?
Now this was serious. The one thing I said to Rob I'd never do was jump out of an aeroplane, and he stitched me right up. Oh well, here we go again.
I'm not going to swear on camera. That was amazing.
So it's Thursday morning and we're getting ready just to go out, and we're going to take the guys to a small but technically challenging motocross track.
Right guys, we're going to go up to the hill now and practice momentum, okay? So we've got a nice little trail just up to it. Remember, get all your momentum on the flat. Getting up to it, you don't want to be putting the power on the hill, okay? Get your momentum on the flat and just roll off the course of the way up.
Nearly. Can I have another go? I'm exhausted. This is the best and the most exhausting thing I've ever done. Lesson in life, never give up.
Rob's bike's awesome, isn't it? Rob's bike is really...
Can we try?
Get off my... Yeah. It's your bike.
It's the end of the day. It's half past eight on... I don't know. Do you know what? I do not even know what day it is today. It's Thursday, I think. We've just been on a nice little trail ride around the back of Brian's house, but it wasn't just a nice little trail ride. We have been to places that you shouldn't go on an Africa Twin. I've had my abilities pushed to the absolute limit. Robbie struggled a couple of things today, got a bit dehydrated really, because we didn't bring enough water out with us. I was struggling, but I just got lucky, I think, because a lot of the times I was at a point out there today where I just thought, I can't do this. But the learning curve again I've been on today, unbelievable, and it just proves what you can do when you push yourself. I've come back far more confident. I've come back, I'm king of the world when I came back today.
5:30, rise and shine. Should be fine after your 4 hours sleep.
Oh, that's cold, but fantastic.
Really looking forward to this. I've brought extra water today because yesterday I dehydrated and I was making some stupid mistakes.
This is sort of the last bit now of this magnificent adventure and journey that me and Rob have been on. We're going to the Pyrenees and we're going to go to apparently somewhere that's going to blow us away, and we've seen so many things that have blown us away already, proving again that all this stuff is out here in the big wide world. There's so much stuff out here. It doesn't cost a lot of money, but it's all about just getting up and doing it. We've said it so many times. We've had a fantastic time here at Brian's. We're leaving, and I don't know about you, I'm nervous again. I always get nervous at the beginning of the day. I'm not nervous in a bad way, but I suppose it's anticipation, isn't it?
That'd be great.
It's going to be great, but do you know what? It's just like yesterday we went out, we didn't know what's going to happen, came back, awesome. Day before that, again. So again, we're off on another sort of mini adventure every day. And as Dave said, we're going to the Pyrenees. I have no idea what to expect, but that's the point.
In the last 6 months, I've had my whole outlook on life changed. I've met some amazing people, I've been to places I've dreamt of visiting, I've ridden thousands of miles, and I've broken down. All because of a second-hand motorbike I thought I'd never own. And finally, I was told, all I had to do was ride it off-road to the top of a mountain.
Every time you turn around, doesn't matter which pole you turn to now, the view is... it's gigantic, it's immense.
To this day, I still don't know why Rob did this for me, but I'm glad he did. I didn't think I had this in me. It's amazing what you can do when you put your mind to it. I now realise all the sweat, tears, pain and hard work were for a reason. I don't know how I'm going to thank Rob for this, but I'll think of something.
So here we are, top of the Pyrenees. 6 or 7 months of planning, training, sweat, tears, stress, you name it. But every single one of them things has been worth it because we're here. I wouldn't say on top of the world, but this is how high now, guys?
2,500 meters.
2,500 meters.
Yeah.
The air's got a bit thin.
Yeah, you can feel it when you're breathing.
Yeah.
A little bit more difficult to breathe. It feels like working a bit harder on the bikes.
Definitely.
Yeah.
But this is not an easy place to get to normally, Dave, is it?
Not really, no. No, I mean, we're a quarter the height of Everest here, put it that way. So it's probably more than that, actually. So it is a high place. And the trails to get up here aren't straightforward gravel tracks. There's a little bit of riding, as you guys found out today. And, you know, with the bikes you're on, you've done an amazing job to get up here. You know, here we are. In the distance, you can see the eagles down there wheeling around on the thermals. You know, we're even above the birds. We're even above the snow line, what's left of it. There's actually snow patches beneath us here. I mean, it goes without saying, really, that you can't get anywhere in life, whether it's riding a motorbike or doing anything in the world that you really want to do. If when it gets hard and you get tired, you stop, well, then you're not going to get anywhere, are you? And doing things like this, the things that you've chosen to do, it's not, you don't just learn about motorbiking, do you? You learn about life.
We've just got to move the bikes because apparently this is where the rafts come in, because they do white water rafting here, which we haven't got time to do, which is tragic. But we've just come back from the Pyrenees. I've got one thing to say. The things that I've done, if I've inspired my children or inspired at least one person out there to do anything you wanted to do, then I don't know about you, Rob, but I've done my job. My honest view is, if you want to do something, just do it. If you want to sit there and do absolutely nothing and live your life on TV, that's cool as well. But personally, this is what it's all about. And this is where the journey ends, sort of thing. We've got to go from here now, although through France, but it's going to be just a journey home now. As you know, I've been, you might have seen the rest of the programme. This could be at the end, I don't know. I've had lots of moments wanting to go home. I said at the top of the Pyrenees that I'm absolutely so pleased that I didn't turn back, because I would have missed everything I've seen. It's been frightening, it's been exhilarating, and it's been low and sometimes a bit depressing, but I would have missed it for the world. And as I say, we wanted to aim for the horizon, and that's our horizon, and we did it.
God, Jesus, that was worse than last time. Oh, Christ.
Dave, I can't take no more.
Honestly, I know I said last time in Wales, don't ever want to see him again. You wrote me into it again.
I didn't know it was going to be that bad again, did I? I thought after last time it'd be better.
Dave,
can't believe that.
I think, honestly, me and you are going to have part company. I know you've been a big sponsor, man, but...
Do you know what?
Do I think it's going to be the end of the road? You've just put me through it again. It's strange.
I don't even know what to say. I'm so sorry.
They're the biggest bunch of bloody toss I've ever met in my life.